Good morning. Welcome to the House of the Lord, to St. Philip Lutheran Church here in Raleigh, North Carolina, for our service of worship and praise this Sunday morning. This is the first Sunday in Lent. Lent is a church season of repentance and contrition when we recall that God's Word says, if my people who are called by my name would humble themselves, pray, seek my face, and turn from their wicked ways, I would hear from heaven, I would forgive their sin, and I would heal their land. And again, the sacrifice acceptable to God is a broken spirit, a broken and a contrite heart, thou, O God, wilt not despise. We are absolutely delighted that you have chosen to worship with us this morning, either here in person or online. We are blessed by your presence and your participation in this morning's worship service. Last but not least, we would like to thank you for your continued financial support of our mission and ministry here at St. Philip. We could not do it without you. We never take that for granted. You may continue to give here in person, obviously, through the mail or via our church website, which is stphilip.org. That's st-philip.org. At this time, we ask that you please rise as you are able for the brief order of confession and forgiveness of sin found printed on page 2 of your bulletin, which begins our worship experience. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who journeys with us these 40 days and sustains us with the gift of grace.
Amen. Amen.
Let us acknowledge before God and one another our need for repentance and God's mercy. Holy God, we confess to you our faults and failings. Too often we neglect and do not trust your holy word. We take for ourselves instead of giving to others. We spoil rather than steward your creation. We cause hurt though you call us to heal. We choose fear over compassion. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us as we seek to follow in your way of life. Amen. Beloved, hear the good news. God so loved the world that God gave the only Son so that all might receive life. This promise is for you. God embraces you with divine mercy, forgives you in Christ's name, and revives you in the Spirit's power.
Amen.
Our gathering hymn this morning is How Sweet the Name of Jesus Sounds.
Sounds zero, we were saved.
And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Lord God, our strength, the struggle between good and evil rages within and around us, and the devil and all the forces that defy you tempt us with empty promises. Keep us steadfast in your word, and when we fall, raise us again and restore us through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated for the reading of God's holy word.
The first reading this morning is from Genesis, second chapter. The Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden, and till it and keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, "You may freely eat of every tree of the garden, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat, for in the day that you eat of it, you shall die." Now the serpent was more crafty than any other wild animal that the Lord had made. He said to the woman, "Did God say, 'You shall not eat from any tree in the garden?'" The woman said to the serpent, "We may eat of the fruit of the trees in the garden, but God said, 'You shall not eat of the fruit of the tree that is in the middle of the garden, nor shall you touch it, or you shall die.'" But the serpent said to the woman, "You will not die, for God knows that when you eat it, when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." So when the woman saw the tree was good for food, and that it was a delight to her eyes, and that the tree was to be desired to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate, and she also gave some to her husband, who was with her, and he ate. Then the eyes of both were opened, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together to make loincloths for themselves. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Please read responsively Psalm 32. "Happy are they whose transgressions are forgiven, and whose sin is put away.
Happy are they to whom the Lord imputes no guilt, and whose spirit there is no guile."
While I held my tongue, my bones withered away because of my groaning all day long.
For your hand was heavy upon me day and night. My moisture was dried up as in the heat of summer.
Then I acknowledged my sin to you and did not conceal my guilt. I said, "I will confess my transgressions to the Lord." Then you forgave me the guilt of my sin.
Therefore, all the faithful will make their prayers to you in time of trouble. When the great waters overflow, they shall not reach them.
You are my hiding place. You preserve me from trouble. You surround me with shouts of deliverance.
I will instruct you and teach you in the way that you should
Do not be like horse or mule, which have no understanding, who must be fitted with bit and bridle, or else they will not stay near you.
Great are the tribulations of the wicked, but mercy embraces those who trust in the Lord.
Be glad, you righteous, and rejoice in the Lord. Shout for joy, all who are true of heart. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
The second reading is from Romans, 5th chapter. Just as sin came into the world through one man, and death came through sin, and so death spread to all, because all have sinned, sin was indeed in the world before the law. But sin is not reckoned when there is no law. Yet death exercised dominion from Adam to Moses, even over those whose sins were not like the transgression of Adam, who is a type of the one who is to come. But the free gift is not like the trespass. For if the many died through the one man's trespass, more surely have the grace of God and the gift of grace in the one man. Jesus Christ abounded for the many. And the free gift is not like the effect of the one man's sin, for the judgment following one trespass brought condemnation, but the free gift following many trespasses brings justification. If because of the one man's trespass, death exercised dominion through that one, much more surely than those who receive the abundance of grace and the free gift of righteousness exercise dominion in life through the one man, Jesus Christ. Therefore, just as one man's trespass led to the condemnation for all, so one man's act of righteousness leads to justification and life for all. For just as the one man's disobedience, the many were made sinners, so by the one man's obedience, the many will become made righteous. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 4th chapter, beginning with the first verse.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. He fasted 40 days and 40 nights, and afterwards he was famished. The tempter came and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread." But he answered, "It is written, one does not live by bread alone, but by every word which comes from the mouth of God." Then the devil took him to the holy city and placed him on the pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and on their hands they will bear you up, so that you will not dash your foot against a stone." Jesus said to him, "Again it is written, do not put the Lord your God to the test." Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. And he said to him, "All these I will give you if you will fall down and worship me." Jesus said to him, "Away with you, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve only him." Then the devil left him, and suddenly angels came and waited on him. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. At this time, we invite Kai Thoreau forward to give us our children. Kai, you look wiser, yeah. Kai.
This is...
You look wiser.
Yes, this is Kai 0.5. So I would like to welcome any of God's children, both big and small, forward that would wish to come forward.
Big, right?
Okay. Big or small.
Okay.
So now imagine that your mom has placed two baskets on a table. One bowl is filled with delicious fruit that is healthy for you and will make you strong. The other bowl is filled with candy. Yum. Look at this. Doesn't that look good? Yeah, and she says, you can eat any of the fruit from this basket that you want, but you cannot eat any of the candy as it is not healthy and can cause cavities. Yeah, and we all know, right? As soon as you're told not to do something, what do you want to do? Yeah, exactly, that very thing. So that is what our reading was about today. So in the beginning, God had created everything, and he placed Adam and Eve in the garden and told them to take care of it. And he says, you're free to eat any of the fruit except the candy from the middle of the garden on the tree. Right? And once you did that, have you ever had a conversation with yourself about that? Did you ever say, ooh, I was really told not to have this candy, but it sure really looks good, and mom will never, ever know if I eat one, right? Yeah, and much like that, the snake was the cleverest of all God's creatures, and he had talked to Eve, and he had told her that if she ate from the candy that she wouldn't die, that they would be like God, and they would know everything, including good and evil, right? So what happens after we give in to temptation and we eat a piece of candy? Do we feel a little guilty or a little remorseful? Yeah, and we fluff up the basket so it doesn't look like we took one, and we go and hide the wrapper. Yeah, so much like that, Adam and Eve, after they ate from the fruit from the tree of knowledge, they realized they were naked, and they clothed themselves in fig leaves. So now that is the story of Adam and Eve and how they were tricked by the sneaky snake. And I'm sure you know the rest of the story. Adam and Eve, they were punished. So if you take the candy that mommy says you can't have, do you get a timeout? Yeah, that's the same. So we face temptation every day, but God wants what is best for us. He will help us to resist that temptation if we do what he tells us to do. So pray with me. Hey, God, help us to follow your teaching and do what your word tells us to do. We know that we will sometimes fail, and we ask you to forgive us and set us on the right path. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Waylon. We appreciate you filling in for Kai. Kai is at the LYO event. That stands for Lutheran Youth Organization. They have an annual meeting/extravaganza/retreat every February. So he is there in Greensboro with one of our youth and another of our adult chaperones. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Good and gracious Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for this day. This day that we have not seen before, a day full of opportunity for worship and rest and fellowship. We thank you, Lord, for the gift of each other, the fact that whatever we are going through in our life, None of us is undergoing it alone, but that we have each other and we can lean on each other in our times of need. We thank you for this church family. And now, Lord, we ask that you would speak to us a word of challenge and conviction, a word of liberation and freedom, a word of hope, power, promise, transformation, and ultimately joy. All this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. My sermon text for this first Sunday in Lent is the first lesson, the Old Testament lesson from the book of Genesis, which, as you know, is the first book of your Bible, chapter 2, verses 15 through 17, and then skipping to chapter 3, verses 1 through 7. It's found printed in your bulletin if you would like to follow along. My sermon title for this morning is based upon chapter 3, verses 5 and 7, where it mentions eyes being opened. My sermon title for today is Eyes Truly Opened. Eyes truly opened. During the years that I've been preaching since my ordination, I have preached most frequently from the four Gospels, namely Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, since they tell the life story of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. That comes as no surprise. I suspect that is also the case for most, if not all, Christian preachers. Other than that, I have preached most frequently from the books of Genesis and Acts. I never really thought that much about it. I just thought they had the best stories. Until one day someone pointed out to me that they were both books of beginnings. Genesis in the Old Testament, narrating the original creation of the world and the human race, and Acts in the New Testament, narrating the beginning of the Christian church after Jesus' death and resurrection. I think in many ways, many of us, even if subconsciously, are just trying to get back, to go back in time and or space to a simpler time, a more innocent time, home, however it is that you might define that. Genesis, the first book of the Bible, begins majestically. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep. The Spirit of God was moving over the waters. And God said, "Let there be light." And there was light. And God saw that the light was good. There are really two different creation accounts in the opening chapters, purporting to come from two different sources. The first account from the opening words, chapter 1, verse 1, through chapter 2, verse 4. The second account of creation from there, chapter 2, verse 4, through the end of chapter 3. There are subtle differences in tone, style, vocabulary, etc. But perhaps the main difference is where humankind falls in the order of creation. In the opening chapter, humankind is created last, after everything else, while in the subsequent chapter, humankind is created first, before, for example, vegetation and the animals. Our text this morning, whose details are a little more filled out, comes from the second of those accounts. This particular text is chosen intentionally for the first Sunday in Lent, and is paired with the gospel narrative of Jesus' temptation in the wilderness by the devil for perhaps obvious reasons. Jesus is successful in his battle with temptation against the devil, while Adam and Eve fail in their similar battle against the serpent. In an overall sense, then, Jesus is reversing the order of the state of creation by conquering what Adam and Eve could not. Our second lesson, assigned for today from Paul's letter to the Romans, makes it clear. Whereas Adam and Eve fell into temptation, thereby inviting sin followed by death into this world, and subsequent humankind was enslaved to death and sin, Jesus conquered temptation, defeated sin, and cheated death by his resurrection, thereby securing for subsequent humanity the free gift of righteousness and everlasting life. Jesus, put quite simply, is doing what our original parents could not. He is reversing the fall of humankind and restoring and reconciling us back to God. If you think about this text from Genesis more deeply, I submit to you that it is easy to sympathize with Adam and Eve. The text opens up. The Lord took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to till it and to keep it. The first charge, duty, assignment of humanity is to till and keep creation, to benevolently watch over it, making sure that it flourishes. The Lord God commanded the man, "You may freely eat of every tree of the garden, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat, for in the day that you eat of it, you shall die." Now, everyone in here who has ever interacted with a child knows the root of temptation comes precisely from such pronouncements. You can do anything you want, just don't do this one thing. You can go anywhere you want, just not into that room. You can date whomever you want, not just him, just not her. Particularly with children, but also with adults, the lone prohibition you give is the exact thing that intrigues, attracts, piques one's curiosity. That's the definition of taboo, isn't it? The allure, the enticement of what's forbidden. Oftentimes, if and when permission is granted, all the fun disappears. Secondly, if this tree is so dangerous, why is it even there? Why does God place it in the garden with Adam in the first place? Couldn't God just have created it some other place, or at least put some uncrossable barrier surrounding it? I mean, you don't leave the kitchen with a gas stove on and say to a toddler, "By the way, when I'm gone, don't touch that blue flame over there," do you? And thirdly, what makes you think Adam even understands the penalty of death in the first place? He's just been created. No one else yet even exists. He's not even so much seen the death of a flower. It's okay, you can chuckle and laugh. How can a threat be a deterrent when you don't even know what it means? You can see we're cruising for a bruising quite rapidly here. Now let's go a little deeper. The very next verse, which we don't read because it's outside of our assigned text, so they've left it out, says, "Then the Lord God said, 'It is not good for the man to be alone. I will make him a helper as his partner.'" Eventually, in verse 21, God takes a rib out of Adam's side and creates woman who will eventually be named Eve. So my point is that Eve wasn't even around yet when God gave his command not to eat the fruit of this particular tree. Adam alone received the command because Eve didn't even yet exist. Now, obviously she's aware of the prohibition by her dialogue with the serpent in chapter 3. But she's only heard about it, apparently and presumably, secondhand from Adam, as opposed to firsthand from God. So that at least possibly dilutes the force of it. Furthermore, some ancient biblical translations, leave out the phrase from verse 6 there, "who was with her," leading many scholars to posit that Adam wasn't around when this original temptation occurred at the hands of the serpent. It was only the serpent and Eve. That is not to exculpate Adam from any guilt. He certainly ate of it either then or later. But it is to suggest that the one who directly heard and received the divine command perhaps would have been more reluctant to yield than someone for whom the command was hearsay. And to add to your exasperation, what's the serpent even doing there in the first place? Where'd he come from? What kind of garden is this anyway? I don't know. There are some unsavory elements in this account. And finally, when Eve succumbs in verse 6, based on three things. Number one, the tree is good for food. Number two, it was a delight to the eyes. And number three, it was desire to make one wise. two of those three harken back to chapter 2, verse 9, wherein God purposely designs the trees of the garden to be, and I quote, pleasant to the sight and good for food. I'm starting to admire Adam and Eve for holding off as long as they did. I probably would have succumbed much sooner. Let's transition, shall we? It's done. The so-called fall of humankind, wherein sin and death enter the world, follows by one mere chapter, a creation about which the biblical author can write, and God saw everything that he had made, and behold, it was very good. Notice the location of this particular tree in the garden, my friends. According to chapter 3 and verse 3, you shall not eat of the fruit of the tree that is where? In the middle of the garden. Its location is central to everything else. That's sad, isn't it? You get the sense that once the middle is messed up, everything else will be messed up. Once the core is violated, becomes rotten, everything else becomes corrupt too. Once your soul's relationship with God is severed, it makes sense that the rest of your life would fall apart or perhaps just become empty. Ironically enough, the serpent told the truth in one way. He says in verse 5, your eyes will be opened. And in verse 7, the eyes of them both were opened. But rather than opened in wisdom, they are opened in shame. They knew that they were naked, so they sewed fig leaves together, made loincloths for themselves. Apart from its literal meaning, being naked metaphorically means being weak, vulnerable, helpless. Does anyone know what it's like to be weak, vulnerable, helpless? To have to sew fig leaves together to mask those things? To have to disguise and hide behind your guilt, your shame, the way you really are? Because if the truth came out, it would have devastating and catastrophic consequences. And so we hide ourselves from God and from one another. Do you know what I consider the chief irony in this text, my friends? Verse 5 of chapter 3, the middle part of the serpent's temptation. Your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. You will be like God. Some say that's the real heart of this temptation, to be like God. The reason that's ironic, chapter 1, verses 26 and 27. Then God said, let us make humankind in our image according to our likeness. So God created humankind in his image. In the image of God, he created them, male and female, he created them. I want to be like God. Yet I'm already created in his likeness. I want to be God-like, and yet I'm already created like God. They are being tempted, my friends, with something that they already possess. They are already, as is, created in the image of God and in God's likeness. You know what illustration or metaphor the earliest church fathers used for sin? They said sin was like a dog with a piece of meat in its mouth, running beside a stream of water, who stops and sees its reflection in the water and opens its mouth to acquire the meat it sees in the reflection in the water, thereby dropping the real meat in its possession for a futile attempt at an unreal reflection in the water. Being tempted with what you already possess. How can the devil tempt us, my friends, with something we already have? How can the serpent tempt us with being someone or being something that we already are? How can you tempt us with being like God when we are already made in God's likeness? That's like offering me 100 pennies when I've got a dollar bill in my wallet. That's like offering to take me to the movies when I've already seen it. How can we be tempted with love when we are already loved? How can we be tempted with acceptance when we are already accepted? How can we be tempted with excitement when we are already joyful? How can we be tempted to security, however one defines that, when God says, "Seek ye first the kingdom of God, and all the rest shall be added unto you." And your heavenly Father knows what you need before you even ask Him. How can you tempt me to a better life when I've already received life more abundantly? How can you play on my fear of death when I already know that death has no sting? It has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is thy sting? Where, O death, is thy victory? How can you tempt us with a tree when you and I already are trees? Planted by streams of water, Psalm 1 says about us, which yield our fruit in season, our leaves do not wither, and all we do, we prosper. You and I, my friends, were created very good. In the image and likeness of God, you and I were created. And yes, we fell into sin, and as a result, into death. But Jesus Christ has come. He has lived, died, and been resurrected and promised to come again, not to deceive us with false hope or illusory dreams, but rather to redeem us, to restore us, and to reconcile us back to God, to confer upon us the free gift of His own righteousness, to exchange yokes with us that we might have rest for our souls, and to bestow upon us His peace which passes what? All understanding. None of those are empty cliches or hollow platitudes, but they are all very real promises of God. So we can sing along, we can believe along with that old gospel song. I told Satan, "Get thee behind. Victory today is mine." But it's not yours because of your own strength or fortitude. It's not yours because you will successfully battle temptation from here on out in your life. Victory is yours because of Jesus. When you are weak, He is strong. When you fall short, He achieves. When you drop exhausted, He perseveres. When you see nothing but sin, He forgives. When you loathe yourself, He loves you unconditionally. Comparing Adam to Christ, what does Paul say in our Romans reading for today? Just as one man's trespass led to condemnation for all, so one man's act of righteousness leads to justification and life for all. You do not face the devil or his agents of temptation unassisted this Lenten season. The outcome is not in doubt. Some of your efforts will be strong and valiant. Others will be weak and woeful. But because Christ has conquered, you are victorious. And that knowledge means that your eyes are now truly opened. Amen. Please rise once again as you're able as we join in singing our hymn of the day, O Lord, throughout these 40 days.
Living together in trust and hope, we profess our faith.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Sustained by God's abundant mercy, let us pray for the church, the world, and all creation. You alone are God. Sustain your church in times of wilderness. Give vision and wisdom to bishops, their staff, and all entrusted with the ministry of administration. Counsel all who faithfully lead your people into the future. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
You create verdant gardens and expansive deserts. Tend to the needs of every living creature. Bless those who work in fields and orchards, and the world is nourished by the fruits of their labor. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
You know our temptations. Sustain those who govern and legislate. Instill in them a sense of your justice and righteousness, that equity and peace would pervade all the regions and nations of the world. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
You are a hiding place for all in distress. Draw near to exiles and accompany all refugees and immigrants, especially children who travel alone. In times of trouble, trauma, or illness, surround your people with your steadfast love. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
You offer abundance to all. Bless the ministries of hospitality in this place. Care for those who tend to the needs of others, especially worship greeters, coffee hour hosts, and nursery attendants. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
You alone are God. We praise you for the faithful departed in every age. Unite our prayers with theirs until our wilderness journey is complete and we rest in you. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Lord, we continue to lift before you the peoples who have suffered from the earthquakes in Turkey and Syria. We pray that you would heal their hearts and their land. We mourn the passing of Chuck Wolf, and we pray for his wife Cindy and indeed the entire Wolf family. Grant them your consolation. We lift to you now the names of those for whom we have special concern, either silently or aloud. And we pray for healing, comfort, and peace.
So Carol and Jack Booth.
We're all hit rock bottom and are digging out.
Merciful God, receive our prayer. We lift our prayers to you, O God, trusting in your steadfast love and your promise to renew your whole creation through Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen.
As the family of St. Philip, we ask that you open our ears to hear your call for us and guide our feet in following. Help us to be good stewards of our time and treasure and to put our trust in you to provide. We ask for blessings on the life of our faith leaders and that your Spirit guide us in relationship and ministry. We put our hope in you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And now may the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Let us share a sign of God's peace with one another now, as well as with those online via the back cameras and more personally up at the front monitor. God's peace be with you. Jesus instructs us in his most famous sermon of all time, the Sermon on the Mount, not to lay up for ourselves treasures here on earth, where moth and rust consume and where thieves break in and steal. Rather, he says, lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, because there neither moth nor rust consume, and thieves do not and cannot break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. If you have not already given online, we invite you to join with me now in making presentation of all of our tithes and offerings unto the Lord via the offering plates in the back. We thank you very much.
Spirit, called by the power divine. You were led by the light, washed with the water, marked by a sacred sign. You are part of the chosen people. You are children of Abraham. You were bought with a price, saved by a sorrow, saved by the blood of the Lamb. God require of you, nothing in truth you cannot do. This alone, your whole life through, but you walk in the way of the Lord. You were claimed by a cross, graced by a glory, loved by the Lord on high. You were fed by the faith, filled from the fountain, testify. You are part of the chosen people. You are children of Abraham. You were bought with a price, saved by a sorrow, saved by the blood of the Lamb. You are part of the
Wonderful job, choir. Please rise now as you are able for our offertory. Create in me a clean heart, O God. Let us pray. God of good gifts, receive these and all our offerings as we present them in faithful service for the sake of your gospel. Prepare our hearts to receive you in this meal as you pour out your very presence through Christ Jesus, the wellspring of eternal life. Amen. We celebrate together now the Lord's Supper, the feast of Holy Communion. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. You call your people to cleanse their hearts and prepare with joy for the Paschal feast, that renewed in the gift of baptism, we may come to the fullness of your grace. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Thank you.
Scripture tells us that in the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, we now pray together as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Come and receive Jesus, our strength in the wilderness. You may be seated for the distribution. All are invited. All are welcome to the Lord's table. Children are invited forward for a blessing. Please simply follow the directions found printed in your bulletin and of the ushers. God bless you. Please rise to receive our post-communal blessing. And now may the eating of Christ's body and the drinking of his blood strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Let us pray. Embodied God, at your table we have tasted the goodness of Jesus. With the eyes of our hearts open to your promise, empower us to hear the needs of our neighbors and touch the world with your love. Amen.
What is our mission?
Jesus asked that we love the Lord our God with all our heart and with all our soul and with all our mind. This is the greatest and first commandment. Jesus tells us that a second is like it. We shall love our neighbors as ourselves. We answer that call, and we go out to share the love of Christ. Thanks be to God.
Please remain standing for just a couple of announcements and mission opportunities. Please, once again, if you have not already done so, remember to pick up a Lenten devotional outside. It's a small book. It'll be there on the Welcome Center counter or maybe even elsewhere in the Narthex. It's blue and green in cover. It's entitled Water in the Spirit. It is a daily devotional for these 40 days of Lent. It has a brief scripture followed by a brief reflection followed by a brief prayer. All the scriptures are from John's Gospel, so it effectively walks you through the Gospel of John in these 40 days. Please pick up one for yourself and your family if you've not already done so. On Wednesday, because it begins Lent, our schedule is just a tad different. Pastor's Bible study on the book of Acts will continue at 10:30 a.m. in the music room. At 6:30 p.m., we'll have a worship service. This Lent is going to be Tazay, worship at 6:30 p.m., which means that evening Bible study will be at 7 p.m. You are welcome to all of that. Please come out. And finally, this is our 60th anniversary this year as a church. Please call the church office if you would like to join the planning team. It's a very exciting time, and they are already beginning to put great ideas forth. So call the church office if that is your desire. Are there any further announcements at this time? If not, receive the benediction of our Lord. And now may God, the giver of love, Christ, the resurrection and the life, and the Holy Spirit of rebirth bless you in this Lenten journey. Amen. Our sending hymn now is Hear Us Now, Our God and Father.
Oh.
I neglected to mention two good friends of mine visiting today, Jamie and her son Jaden. Welcome. It's great to have you. You're welcome here anytime and all the time. Please greet them on your way out. And now go in peace. Follow the way of Jesus. Thanks be to God.